on the city council or the planning commission, and so we kind of, I know, so start counting Tim and John. So I'm well, council of the mayor for a year. I was 9 years on the city council, and actually 3 years on the planning commission before that, so.
Planning commission 2002. Oh, man, that's weird.
I'm Rich Mag. I was on the council since 2005, and the planning commission since 2000.
I'm Heather Kingston, city attorney. I've been the city attorney for about a year.
I'm Sue Ann Martin Smith. I am on the planning commission in Pleasantville.
Carrie Salee, associate planner, and I'll be here as of Thursday.
And Nick Bond, development director. Been here going on 4 years now.
I'm Percy, public works director, city engineer, going on 9 years.
I sit on the city council in my second year.
City council, 5 years.
John Clausen, and I think I'm starting my 35th year on city council. And about 6 years prior to that on civil service commission.
Mark Sling, city commissioner, but you're half 2 years old.
I'm Tim Durian, and I've been 12 years, if I use your math, on the city council. I know, yeah, we gave us a
is that the new math?
A partner on the planning commission
for about less than 6 months.
I'm Becky Ashby, and I've been on the city council. I've completed 3 years, and I had 2 separate terms on the planning commission, 6 years each, and 1 term on the civil service commission, replacing Mr. Clausen.
I'm Sean Cucciardi, 14 months into the city council, was on the civil service commission prior to that.
All right, and I just got a couple more things I just wanted to share. I figured next week was too late. We had some wonderful young men and women from junior ROTC that paid a service yesterday in our community. We saw them running around picking up garbage, cleaning things up. I just wanted to commend them, and they also retired tattered flag in front of City Hall yesterday at the NISO ceremony. So I just wanted to thank them, call them out, and acknowledge their efforts. And then my second little, you know, some of us were at a homeless meeting this afternoon, and before the end of the month, Methodist Church over here will have a severe weather shelter opened. And DEM reported that they have closed the training session because they have 60 volunteers. And we've never had that strong of a turnout for a training session for volunteers. So hats off to our community. That's really cool. And we'll have that opened up toward the end of the month. Shortly after the first of the month, we'll have the showers at the Lutheran Church. And we're still trying to raise the dollars to come up with some vouchers, social vouchers for folks in crisis. So really glad to be here this afternoon. So, That's the hotel voucher for Crowley. Oh, okay, yeah, that's that flyer that I'm going to email on. Yeah, so sorry. All right, we are to this great big binder.
Thank you. And I want to start out by with a thank you and an apology. I'll apologize first, and I'm sorry that this only got to you at the end of the day on Friday. We didn't receive some of the last little pieces of code until Friday afternoon that we were waiting on attorney review, and so we got it out as soon as we could, but I certainly don't expect you to have read this entire thing cover to cover, so if you didn't do that, that's okay, and I think even having not read the staff report is probably something you should pat yourself on the back for. It's not the most interesting subject matter.
Alistair Deere likes it.
I also want to thank Carrie for all of her work on this. She's been really doing a lot of the heavy lifting on assembling codes and reorganizing things and helping put the finishing touches on this, and I definitely wouldn't have met the deadline that we set for ourselves back in November without all of her So what you have before you today is what we've proposed is a new unified development code, land use and development code. And currently, the structure of our city code has various provisions related to development scattered across a few different titles that were all created at different times. And we've never taken a step to wholly and seamlessly integrate the different provisions, whether it's our SEPA chapter, which is in Title 14, our stormwater regulations in Title 15, which we actually just had to adopt before the end of the year to take effect on January 1st, our building code, which is in Title 15, our land use and zoning code in Title 16, our critical area codes in Title 18. All of those things have sort of been adopted at one time or another, but separately without consideration of how those things fit together. And so tonight, you know, I want to get into some substance of the revisions, but I really want to focus more on the architecture and the process for moving forward with considering this proposal. As you remember, back in October, we brought forward a proposal that had to do with organizing the department and to create a permit center for the city. And what we had found is that public works and planning and building have been operating independently of one another, and either because building used to be under public works and is now under planning, but either way, we've had different staffs handling different types of permit processes over the years. And what we've learned is that we had very different permit procedures from one department to the next. As part of our effort to reorganize the department to create this permit center, which is a singular point for getting permits through the city, we also wanted to create a uniform process for permit submittals, review, timelines, what people can expect in terms of the process. And we wanted to try to sync those codes up in such a way that it was more streamlined, and hopefully we as a department and as a city could be more efficient and provide better service to our citizens and the development community. In the last year and a half, the city council, I guess in mid-2015, was asked to adopt interim regulations for permit processing and subdivisions to address some possible risk issues, inconsistency with state law, and other issues. And those interim regulations were then readopted in February of 2016, and we were given a year to work through them and come up with a proposal. And many of those regulations went to a committee that the mayor formed that consisted of various stakeholders and some experts in their field, engineering, private engineers, and other folks. And so prior to November, we were able to get most of those code sections to that committee, and then we hit the holidays, and we hit a stormwater deadline for getting that code adopted, and so we really weren't able to take. There's still a handful of sections that haven't been to that committee. But we have been working towards replacing those interim ordinances, and this unified code replaces the interim codes and then also reorganizes our development code and does all the things that I was mentioning at the beginning of my talk here. So there's also, over the last year and a half, we've had to do other things, including we had to adopt the 2015 building codes, which is a state mandated action we do every 3 years. We took steps to refine our shoreline master program, which that code revision has to be approved by Ecology, and it's still pending review and the end of an appeal period, I believe. And so we did that in, this past fall. As I mentioned, we did the stormwater code. And so we've had all of these steps that had mandated deadlines, which we had to meet those deadlines at the same time we were trying to put together this pretty massive overhaul of our code and this reorganization. So it's been very complicated with all the moving pieces. But this step that we're taking here to consolidate everything into one title, I think, is the biggest step that we need to take in terms of providing an architecture for a code that we can build on and really get into the more exciting code revisions, which includes updating development design standards, providing more user-friendly zoning, things that are going to result in the type of development that the comp plan and the city council and the planning commission envision for the city. But really, the way that our code had been structured previously, we had so many problems to fix that we haven't been able to move to those new more exciting items until we could clean up some of the old problems. So this is our first draft. That is the first draft that we put together where everything is unified, everything is numbered and sort of structured the way that we had envisioned it, but it's still a draft, and I want to emphasize that this, you know, definitely could stand a great deal more vetting with the community. And so in my staff report, I outlined really that we have two options, and the two options are the result of our self-imposed deadline to replace the interim ordinances that we've put into place. And our interim subdivision code and our interim permit processing code are set to expire mid to end of February this year. And so really we have two choices, and I think council really wanted to see a replacement for that by February. And so this meeting was scheduled as a joint meeting to discuss that replacement. However, there's nothing that says the council can't extend that deadline if it would like to take more time to review this and study it and make sure that we get it done right. And that would be my proposal at this point in time, would be to take the second alternative and make sure that we take this to the Development Regulations Committee, we vet it a little bit more, we do a little bit more outreach, and give you all a chance to fully read the document and study it to the extent that it deserves.
So we're at a crossroads here. So either we're diving into this whole heart of it tonight and subsequent meetings very fast to make a self-imposed deadline, or we're kicking at that what Nick's just proposed. So at this point, I guess I'm looking to some heads nodding for the city council that you're comfortable with in February, us extending our self-imposed deadline and going through a bite-sized pieces of this and continuing our process through the code development committee and then taking it to the planning commission in bite-sized pieces and then the city council bite-sized pieces, which we're probably talking 4 to 6 months.
I think that would be the direction the committee would prefer, because there's still a great deal of input that has to take place.
I agree. Yes. This is a huge volume of work. I can't imagine how much time this is taking. I mean, this is like cleaning out your closet.
Well, it's a year's worth of work, and yeah. Only pieces of it, or you know, some of it's been, or a good portion has been dead, but not all of it. And as Nick said, there's more work to do.
I think it would be wise, and just give me a second here. I think it would be wise if we took this a bite at a time, because this is a huge, I tried to read this, I just couldn't do it. So I did get through, I skimmed through enough of it, and I, they've done so much work that I think we ought to take a little bit more time and thoughtfully go through this and take it in bite-sized chunks, as you say, and then absorb them and digest them and then give our consideration.
And just for council's information, one of the things that the mayor asked, which was a good question, is why don't we just adopt the permit processing and subdivision portion of this revised code, which has at least partially been vetted, and move forward with that. And I think from a staff administration standpoint, if we were to introduce yet another interim code and have projects come in under a new set of rules, that would just further complicate and sort of slow us down. And so I think, you know, whether you like the interim code or not, it's a lot easier for us from an administrative standpoint to stick with what we have for a few more months and then move forward with a new permanent solution rather than introducing yet another interim iteration of a code revision. The other thing that I wanted to mention is that in conjunction with this update, we have had very good meetings, and Clancy's been a part of our sign regulation committee. And we have scheduled our final meeting with that committee, which means that the sign regulations are also ready to go to the Planning Commission for review. And so it would not be difficult to kind of merge that process into this unified code, as well as we do have another mandate for our critical areas code update, which is the end of June. And so my proposal be that we bring all these things together into one process and move them forward together rather than having separate code processes going parallel to this. And so I want to, you know, I want a direction on that before we try to integrate that. But
anybody have any concerns with that work plan?
My comment is, first of all, I'm supportive of the alternative two, because I do not believe that it's had the appropriate, I don't think we can get the work done we need to by a vote in February. But with that said, we adopted those interim regulations a year, wow.
2015.
No, I was thinking a year and a half ago, if not more. And now we're extending another 6 months. We've had a year and a half to do this work, and we haven't seemed to be able to accomplish it. So
I guess I would argue we have compiled it.
We've compiled it, but there's places in here that aren't vetted yet.
Correct.
That haven't been studied by anyone. So I've got no problem taking another 6 months, but I don't want this body in 4 to 6 months being hearing, gee, we still have yada yada yada. I mean, we've had a year and a half.
I hear you. We can give it to you as fast as we can digest it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's created. It's just we feel it's important. I think we all do that. We continue the public process with it. We, from a stakeholders committee standpoint, because there's parts of this that haven't been in the stakeholders committee.
Are there some things that just administratively we could do to make sure that we were done in the 6 months, like have a regular, and maybe you already do, I don't know, but a scheduled stakeholders meeting at a consistent time and a consistent day?
We were, but as Nick pointed out, the holidays came, and it's happened every year. Maybe we should need to plan for those. The other piece is the mandatory stormwater update. We had to set everything aside to get that stormwater updates done. So we were, I mean, it was happening pretty consistently. Gary and Bill, they were there at most of the meetings, and we had Norm and a couple of other folks from from the engineering sector that have technical expertise. So we were plugging along pretty good until November, and we kind of had set aside, and that's what you have.
Yes, I would say kind of along the same lines as back. I'm interested in taking the time to do it, but let's get it done. And I guess I would ask from the staff's perspective, you had suggested bringing a couple more components to what we already have. Hearing the discussion about wanting to get it done in 6 months, do you believe that that's feasible, bringing in the signed ordinance and whatever?
So the critical areas code is required by June 30th. So if we're going to take 4 to 6 months, that's putting us pretty close to June, in which case we really ought to incorporate that one into these changes. The sign code, obviously we all know about the Supreme Court case that was handed down, and so there is some urgency to fix that, but I don't think it's as critical that come forward on the same schedule necessarily. We can just simply move our existing sign code over into this temporarily. And really until we release that draft of the sign code to the public and see what sort of feedback there is, it's hard to gauge how complicated or simple that's going to be for people to understand.
Well, if that's the case, then I would suggest we leave that separate just so that we can get the majority of this completed. And then my next question is, our friends on the Planning Commission, what you know is going before them in the next 6 months, is it going to be reasonable to assume that these folks are going to get through this as well?
Yeah, the Planning Commission's schedule is pretty wide open until the comp plan amendment deadline on June
going to get all of us at once?
Yeah.
Okay.
So first of all, the Planning Commission has already received some of these items. I know the SEPA ordinance already has had a public hearing at the Planning Commission and has a recommendation, but it was on hold until we get integrated into this. I believe we've done a study session on non-conforming uses, conditional use permits, variances, and
temporary uses.
And so they've seen those items. And a whole lot, I mean, even though this is a thick packet, a lot of this is just renumbering our existing code sections. So if this is intimidating, keep in mind that the table of contents and the staff report kind of outlines what was just moved versus what is rewritten. So I think two things to study, specifically the subdivision and permit processing chapters, would cover, and then also the critical areas code would cover the bulk of the revisions.
And it's coming to the City Council in a year or two?
Yeah, whether we want to do it during our regular study session or potentially look at a special.
Well, I'm just going to ask you here, what's our study sessions look like? If we carve out a portion of each one of them to take it?
The way we're going to have to do this. Yeah, I think what we're going to have to do is this is heavy lifting, and we're going to need to take some of these smaller items and put them as discussion items on our business meetings so that we can clear the works. If we need to devote an hour and a half, realistically, other than Scott Diener, I think all of us in about an hour and a half of code, and our eyes go back in our head, and we've lost. Lost focus. I mean, it's not real. You can't spend 2 or 3 hours on this and do an effective job. So I think we've got to, whether it's the Planning Commission or the City Council, you've got to break it up into pieces, to have meaningful discussion of it. So we're going to need to look at that and the items that are there, and probably do more discussion items on the end of our City Council meetings, to be honest.
Okay, so it's pretty clear that extending the existing interim ordinance is preferred, and that's something that I would propose to bring on February 14th and extend those through, I guess 6 months is going to put us to the first meeting of August. Ideally, I'd like to have this done by June in time to adopt the critical areas code update, and I think that's an achievable deadline at this point. And then we'll put the sign regulations on hold, and maybe once this whole thing goes to the Planning Commission or to the City Council from the Planning Commission in April or May could take up the sign regulations as the next step, and hopefully have that lined up ready to go shortly after Council can get to the bulk of the document.
And then we, the Council, then would take the sign regulations and fold them into the code adopted after the fact.
Correct. All right. Any questions about the process or public involvement? moving forward with the actual code document, you'll see that the Title 20 is the proposed Unified Development Code, and we provided just a clean table of contents, and then the staff report sort of follows that table of contents. It's organized in what we hope is a very logical order, with subtitle 1 being the general provisions. The administration chapter is actually very similar to the administration chapter that we currently have. It's been updated by the attorney, but it's largely the same structure. Subtitle 1 includes provisions for how we amend our comprehensive plan and also how we amend our development regulations. It's going to include the overarching definitions to the entire code, but you need to keep in mind that each subtitle may have definitions that are specific to that subtitle, and so you're going to see the highest order of definitions in subtitle 1 and then secondary orders of definitions in their respective subtitles. That way, because some of these codes are not being rewritten at this time, we want to make sure that we don't end up causing inconsistencies through the adoption of our And then finally, rules and interpretation and enforcement. Those are two chapters which are not in your, they're the only two that I'm still waiting on from Sarah Springer. And so those will be provided here shortly. I'll get those to you as soon as I have them. Subtitle 2, moving on, is our permit processing chapter, which that was the interim ordinance that set out how we go about reviewing permits, the five different types of permits, whether they're quasi-judicial, administrative, legislative, et cetera. It outlines our process for providing public notice, and then it includes development agreements and variances. And just a note on the development agreements chapter is not changing. That was carried over from the old code. The variance chapter is entirely new and has been reviewed by the development committee. And we did take recommendations and have incorporated some of the feedback from the committee. And there's some things that were requested that the attorney wasn't comfortable providing, but we did have a pretty thorough discussion on that chapter. And previously, variances were consolidated with conditional use permits, temporary uses, non-conforming uses. However, because variances, you can't provide a use variance. You can't say that we're going to give you a variance to do a certain use in a zone where it's not allowed. The courts have ruled that that's improper use of a variance. Variances are things like setbacks or heights or dimensional standards, and that's why they all come together with the other zoning use type regulations. Subtitle 3 is your zoning chapter. It includes adoption of a zoning map. It outlines the zoning districts, which at this time are not changing, although hopefully we'll get to work on those in the future. And I know economic development has been studying our downtown, and the Land Use Committee, I believe, has been looking at some of the other sections. It includes conditional uses, non-conforming uses, and temporary uses. And it should be noted that we just adopted the interim non-conforming use chapter, so that's something that we'll want to pay special attention to, because I know there were concerns about non-conforming uses and that interim chapter, and so we're trying to bring that interim chapter integrated into our non-conforming use chapter, and that has been discussed at length at the Development Regulations Committee, as has the conditional use permits chapter, and I mentioned both of those went to the Planning Commission. But as far as the zoning tables, they're not changing at this time. We're not really doing much with the overlay district regulations at this time. Subtitle 4, supplemental zoning regulations, these are all unchanged. And then subtitle 5 is what is replacing your interim subdivision code. And this has been totally rewritten from what was provided by Carol Morris. You might find some language that the new attorney pulled from that interim code, but it's mostly a total rewrite of that, and I think it's a lot more succinct and easier to navigate. Subtitle 6 are the development standards and regulations, and so this is not the zoning chapter provided for what uses you can do. This is the chapter that establishes all the standards for what those uses are going to look like when they're actually constructed. So your setbacks, your parking, your landscaping, eventually your design standards for how you orient your buildings, what special setbacks certain areas of town might have. And this is something that definitely will need work in the future, but it's not proposed at this time. And you also find our new land disturbing activity permit has been incorporated into this chapter. The 7th subtitle is our stormwater drainage ordinance, which was just approved in December, and we're just moving it. And we've made a few minor amendments to reference the permit processing chapter, because currently it refers generically to administrative approvals or how the appeals process work, and now it's going to have specific references to other parts of our code. So it's mostly just getting it to fit with the new permit processing chapter that the attorney has provided. Subtitle 8 is all of the city's environmental regulations. And as I mentioned previously, the CEPA ordinance has been rewritten to comply with I think it was a 2012 or 2013 update that the city never incorporated into its code. that's been to the planning commission. It has a planning commission recommendation, and so that's the most complete of all of the items on our to-do list. The critical areas code, if you look in this book, I wouldn't even bother reading it, our existing critical areas code, because it's going to be totally revamped, and we'll release that to you as soon as, I think we're waiting on Department of Ecology comments, and then we are also waiting on attorney review on that.
Well, I think just attorney review at this point.
Just attorney review on that, and then we'll have that available for public viewing for this group to evaluate. The Shoreline Master Program, I mentioned that we amended that in October, and as soon as Ecology accepts our revisions, we'll make sure that those revisions are in the current version of the code that's online and available for review. And then the flood damage prevention, hazardous materials facility warning system, those are just moved from Title 15 to this new chapter. And then finally, our concurrency and impact fee provisions, they're not changing, they're just moving. There aren't changes there. And then subtitle 10 is where you're going to see our building and construction standards. And there are changes to the fire codes. And in August or September, the fire chief and fire marshal sent some proposed revisions to the city asking for us to make those changes. However, because we were considering this bigger update of our code, we didn't want to bring that to the process at that time because we wanted to not have to change it twice, essentially. And so you'll want to read the fire prevention code and the fire sprinklers chapter carefully. The building code is not changing at this time, but it will need to be updated in the future to better integrate with our permit processing chapter. It works right now, but it could be more well integrated, and that's just something that will have to happen little bit later date. And then building numbers and mobile home installation are just removed. So just having walked through the table of contents, you'll see that I think at least half of this is just renumbering existing chapters and putting them in a different location. And hopefully the staff report did an adequate job of describing when that's the case. And really is focusing on permit processing and subdivisions and critical areas and a handful of minor zoning chapters. So I don't know if anybody had a chance to actually dive into this in any significant length, and I don't know whether it would be worthwhile to try to talk about that until you've had more time to review it, but if there are specific questions, we'd be happy to answer them about the substance. But I think, I'm guessing given 3 days, you probably aren't past page 50 of the staff report.
Task. I mean, to, to read in detail. So.
Yeah.
Questions for Nick? Process?
Well, I'm just wondering if maybe we don't try to look at, between now and it's June 15th, kind of put together a master calendar of how things flow through the planning commission back to the city council. Yeah. That way we all kind of have that in front of us and we can really focus on, those bite-sized pieces well in advance. So we have those meetings, we'd be really well prepared. And
I think that would be a great
flowchart almost.
Yeah, now that we have that direction, I think that's something we'll absolutely want to do, and we'll want to work backwards from our
correct
desired finish date, which I would put as the second meeting of June. And
I don't want to be back here talking about why we need expenses. We want exactly what we need to come up with the process, share that process, and everybody needs to buy into that process. This is what we're going to do and when.
Yeah, before council gets in here really deep into this, it probably should go through a public hearing process because there may be changes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yes.
And it's something that was talked about during the planning commission.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there'll be a couple of public hearings at the planning commission. Is the desire going to be to the public hearing of the council multiple in pieces or one gigantic elephant?
No.
Okay.
So I think the one thing that we've learned through the Development Regulations Committee is that there are certain changes that people are going to ask for, And the attorney has pretty good reasons as to why we shouldn't take those steps. And so, you know, I want to make sure that we approach this in a way that we're not trying to make those changes from the floor of a council meeting at the time that we go forward with adoption. And so I think the role of the Planning Commission here is really to take those public comments and to sort of create an index of all the requests that come in on the final draft when we release it for public comment, and to then provide those to the City Council. I'm not sure that the City Council actually wants to be the one to hold the public hearing on this, because they are able to use the Planning Commission's public hearing and the index of requests, and they can see which ones the Planning Commission said, you know, let's make that change, and which ones they said, let's not make that change, and work off of that rather than having sort of a free-for-all on the floor of the City Council meeting.
I guess I was thinking that maybe something in between that, as opposed to doing public hearings on each little section, we take the input from the Planning Commission, and when we do the final adoption, we do one big public hearing. By then, we will have had all of the information that the Planning Commission has heard as well, and their recommendations, and then we just see what we want.
Will there be additional stakeholder meetings before the pieces that haven't been to the stakeholders meeting go there before it gets to the Planning Commission?
Yes, we were waiting to schedule those meetings until we knew that we were going to have until June, because it wasn't going to be possible to make it in time for Planning Commission. But we would like to schedule at least one or two more meetings, and I think, you know, we can get through the at least the interim, the things that are replacing the interim code with that committee. Whether we take the whole document cover to cover back through the committee one more time, that's potentially much more time consuming. But certainly,
I just noticed on here that there were
three or four of them that haven't been, and I bet the intent is to take those sections that haven't been, but not rehash you with the same old material. The material that's been vetted, we're planning to take to the Planning Commission. And then what I'm hearing is we'll have multiple public hearings from the Planning Commission to take testimony, and then there'll be one opportunity at the City Council for a public hearing, and I would assume we would take action in a subsequent meeting, potentially.
And not to be confused with, the Council needs to go through these things in bite-sized pieces before the final adoption, which is the public hearing.
So maybe after the Planning Commission has their public meeting, testimony, we're going to then, this body has our work study with, here's the code, here's the testimony we got on what we'd like to see, and then Nick and the attorney are telling us, yeah, that one's doable, you know, state law says no, we can't do this one, and here's why, so on and so forth.
And then my only other question would be, in terms of the sections that we're simply renumbering, that we really aren't opening for changes, I would be somewhat, unless there was a spelling error or, you know, some other minor thing, I really don't want to open those to substantive changes at this time, just because it's going to bog us down potentially. I would really like to just say this is being renumbered and it's going to be reviewed at a later date, but now is not the time to open this up, unless there's some, you know, just way of making it fit in with the new code or some internal
inconsistency. It's a conflict with the new code that we have to change, but I think we've got more than enough work ahead of us.
So the ones that you are just renumbering, are you going to put a light next to it, what the old number was, so that people could, so they know that if that's all it is, they can actually go back to it?
It's in the summary, but it's not in the text of the document, but we could put chapter 2002 previously. Although, I guess some things were previously a different number and are unchanged, and other things were previously a different number and are significantly revised.
So ones that aren't changed.
Yeah, okay.
The ones that we're changing, I don't think we need to formally known as, because it's not formally. should want to stick around and hear about Cody City and more than welcome to stay. And if you don't, then.
Mr. Mayor, if I may, just before.
Yes.
Since we are all together, I think this might, we could take 5 minutes and search it here for the planning commission or from us. How things are going, and this is stuff that we can do to make our life better, or what you guys can do to make our life better. I mean, we don't get together very often, so it'd be nice just to kind of hear everyone's thoughts about how things are going and what you see ahead of us. But everybody jump in once.
You might as well start that dialogue then.
Well, I'm able to start by sharing an appreciation for what you guys do. I mean, it's sometimes a task that occurs that doesn't seem to be considered or thank you for doing your part in helping us. And I certainly appreciate it, and I wanted to share that. So sometimes it maybe sounds like we don't really give it answers, but we do. At least I do.
I've noticed in the last, probably a year or so or more, that our public hearings are not attended. I mean, we don't hardly have anybody at those meetings anymore. Where we used to have, a few people at those, but there's not. I mean, we've had public hearings on these issues that have come up that have been looked at.
But it makes it easy.
But even on these new regulations and new things,
I think it helps to have a stakeholder committee that has, there's a group of professionals that works with this code every day. I mean, it's not that I don't, it is interesting, but I can only digest so much of this. Those folks work with it every day, know where the shortcomings are, and know what other jurisdictions do. So it's been a tremendous resource that we've leaned on, and hopefully that's contributing to it. And it's not that nobody cares. I certainly hope that folks.
Well, I think you're right. I think they know what's coming, what's going to the city council eventually. So there's not as much trying to change it or consider, which is what we used to.
Yeah.
So Max, if you guys don't know Sue Ann, she's the owner of Homemade Cafe, and when I interviewed her for the planning commission, she's got a lot of energy and keeps on sharing.
Excited to be here.
Those of you planning commissioners have any observations about zoning changes that they thought should happen? And do you feel that you have an avenue expressed? For example, if you think that storage units shouldn't go in every commercial spot, or for example, if you think we have too much commercial area, have you noticed things like that about the city that you would want to tweak?
Well, I think, you know, the only thing that I've kind of worked hard for over the years is to try to keep Tremont non-commercial, you know. At the beginning, as it comes into Orange Boulevard, and I think that's kind of going away now. I think it's going to be a little bit disappointing to see. Well, no, there's the one across the street there. Commercial on Bethel, I'm all for it. It's a, you know, an entryway into our city. I was hoping to commercialize. About an effort, I guess.
And maybe it's to your design standards, that if it is somehow commercial, it's to the standards.
Because it just seems like there's a lot of commercial property that's for sale on Bethel that's not moving.
Yeah.
And it just seems to me, and just from a guy that looks at what's going on, is that people want to take something that's not commercial and make it commercial and develop it instead of taking something that's commercial and develop it. And because it's easier or cheaper. It's cheaper to take this thing that's not commercial, change it to commercial, and develop it. And I don't like that. We've got a lot of commercial property that needs to be utilized before we start commercializing other properties.
The property on Bethel, the buy a commercial piece, would it cost more because you have to buy it and fix that road?
If it's on commercial already, you're paying.
But I mean, if you got something on Tremont though, mm-hmm. and just made it commercial, that you may have a pretty good road. But Bethel has issues.
Any of our road standards are going to require frontage improvements wherever they're at, and the impact fee should be the same depending on the same size development here, the same size development there.
It just seems like Bethel needs a lot of work.
You raise a good point. Just one of the things I'm sitting there thinking about as you're talking about it, you're absolutely correct. But there are also, you know, big chunks of ground on Bethel which lend themselves to, you know, the larger Walmart, Home Depot kind of developments, different than smaller chunk that, say, McDonald's, I think, was mentioned. I don't know how much property on Bethel is smaller pieces suggest status quo for a couple of years. Let's not change anything. Let
well, I, but I think we need to do things like our design standards and not have metal siding, and more if we're gonna have a mini storage, it's gonna be a darn nice looking mini storage because we can't sell them to prevent a mini storage, but it's not gonna be corrugated metal.
I would add to that that one of our challenges, and we've talked a bit about non-conforming uses, especially at our meeting in December, but one of the problems on Bethel is that some of the small pieces of land are residential, but they're zoned commercial. And the way our code is set up right now is it allows the expansion of those non-conforming uses rather than clamping down on expansion of the non-conforming use in order to facilitate consolidation of ownership and people to buy up those pieces for future redevelopment. And so you have to look at your non-conforming use chapter in terms of how it helps you achieve your objectives, which if it helps perpetuate the non-conforming use versus helping bring to an end the non-conforming use, that's going to have a big influence on how those properties are either brought together or are kept separate because they're really flexible for the existing occupant of that property.
Is a meeting like this where we're talking big picture, I think, helpful to this?
Yes.
Could we revisit this in the future?
Yeah, well, and then the planning commissioners aren't feeling like, we'll talk about city council members, they don't have a city.
Well, that's what
the right
example.
This isn't going to help that.
The vision of the council, And that's, I think the last time we had a sit down, it was kind of difficult to discern. So it makes it easier as we, as things pop up on the schedule, we kind of have a better idea of where we want to go as a whole. We've never really had that discussion, I don't think. But I think that
you're absolutely right.
I think times like this to do that would be very helpful. Because knowing where we want to go as a whole helps us when it comes to these little piecemeal things from here and there and how they're all going to fit together.
Because when Gary comes in screaming at the microphone, you can go, yeah, but that doesn't fit with our picture, Gary. I appreciate you.
Gary doesn't.
Tim, I just wanted to echo your concerns about Fremont Corridor. I was on a committee several years ago, and we talked about the business professional use and trying to keep some of the fast food places and whatever out of that area because it's so close to residential and the medical community. And there were a lot of suggestions on how to keep it somewhat regulated so that it kept that kind of appeal as an entryway to the city. That was a great discussion, and I would hate to lose the ground that I think was gained during that. The design standards, I think, are huge, but there are other commercial quarters, I think, where a lot of that development should take place.
So who bought that corner piece then, right at the corner of Fremont and
Pottery?
Which corner? The northeast?
The one that just sold.
With Joe, guys.
We I haven't heard from anybody who's looking to develop that. We had a pre-app on that property a year and a half ago. But
several pre-apps.
Yeah, nothing ever came of those. So I don't know if it's somebody who previously looked at it.
Yeah, because all of a sudden we got our funding and a sold sign.
Yeah.
And
so I think somebody's speculating on.
Yeah, we've
got.
They closed in the name of we've had three or four different, in the last 9 years, actual pre-apps. People, doing their due diligence that never came to fruition. And then in the southwest corner, that recently sold to that business that was next to the chiropractor that was going to buy past council member Colbank's house, and then he decided to go there. It was a foster recruiting business or something.
You mean on Houston's property on the south?
Yeah,
that's a foster care
coordination.
Yeah, that's what
it is.
There's a seaport in there.
So,
Kathleen Wilson from my planning mission. So, one of the things, I'm come back to if that's zoned there, we've got to have the right design standards. And that's we've got, that's on the docket this year. We've got to have good design standards so that we have a community that looks the way we want it to. It doesn't have backwards fences and, you know, the cheap development. It needs to look nicer. The other joint project I think we're going to do is the downtown. And we need to get that on the docket too. And that's probably right after we finish this element
here. That'll fill up your public hearings. That and sign ordinances, those two will definitely fill up your public
hearings. Yeah, so we've got this element, signs, and then, you know, the Economic Development Committee started a little, I think it was Economic Development, the little coloring contest on downtown. And really, we want to take the whole downtown and look not just at the two blocks, but basically from Birch or Boulevard all the way to the roundabout and look at a block. There's places I think that height doesn't impact anybody, and there's places that it impacts people a whole lot. And so we really need to take it block by block and parcel by parcel. And I think we need a joint process, you know, for that one too.
I'm not responsible for bringing the oil company to town.
You're just a bearer of bad news.
Well, the other thing on Tremont, when you said you didn't want to see it on a commercial, I remember Tremont is to move people. Mm-hmm. It's a
corridor.
It's a corridor. It's to move people. It's, and when you have the commercial development, you have a lot of ingress egress on that, and it doesn't quite serve what we need it to serve.
Well, how did that parcel get to be a commercial property anyway? I mean, how
came through or the planning commission on your watch?
No, I don't think so.
Which which property are you?
The one that we were talking about that sold to.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's been it's been commercial since I've been there.
It's been commercial. So I work when I in the 1990 I worked for Olson, so I'm a senior and did the Harrison Hospital project and was part of the redesigning Tremont from South Kid from Hospital West, and then the city had a project going from basically where Tremont Medical is now to I guess Sydney. So there are two projects to it. And that corridor, other than the Tremont corridor plan that was put together, which eliminated or didn't allow fast food, that was like the biggest thing in that plan. That corridor has been zoned commercial, non-fast food since the early 90s. So it's nothing that's happened recently.
Yeah, I think it was done a number of years ago, and it was essentially that, you know, all four corners of that intersection was about the only envisioned commercial, and the rest of it was completely other than down
other than
South Piece of Boulevard.
The healthcare campus that.
Yeah, was to remain residential. So it was these nodes. And in fact, the other one was in the northeast corner of the Boulevard and Tremont,
right,
that
right.
That property was zoned for a big storage part is, looks like they're designed to connect to all people over there in Seville, so you don't have to go on to Bethel. And I don't know if that's something that we assume when we annex that.
It's not currently in our plans, but it's part of the scope that we're developing for the Bethel and Sedgwick corridor study, and I think that's part of the equation of looking at traffic flows. If that frontage road goes in, how does that affect the need for lane width and lane quantity on Bethel? Is it a two-lane or a four-lane with that, and what happens if you don't have that frontage road?
So I vaguely remember seeing something that suggested I'd run all the way through to Santa Maria, at least in that one block from one to Santa Maria.
Yeah, from Kathy, and but they ran into some obstacles between Walmart and then Home Depot where that road, instead of being somewhat linear, the issue was creating, it only lined up to be between the parking lot and Walmart, and they didn't want a freeway between the parking lot and the business, and then, so that's why the easement, Vanessa went over by Wendy's and very circuitous, and then when it got in front of Walmart, it actually went the opposite, or the Home Depot, it actually went behind east of the proposed development, so that then you wind up with much further east on Sandbury. So it's, there's some pros and cons with these frontage roads that you have to look at with all the properties.
You know, when comes, is it Jarvis on the fit? It's going to be tough to get a frontage road between its front door and Bethel.
So Captain, I know you missed the first part of the meeting, so the next planning commission, you guys are going to have all of this to adopt, so.
There will be a test at the end of the evening.
No, the real outcome is we're going to take about less than 6 months, about hopefully 4 months, to take this in bite-sized pieces to the planning commission and do this.
That's better.
All right.
Good.
Thank you, folks.
Can I make one quick comment?
Sir.
One problem with the Bethel corridor, the county had their design standards required that the buildings be put right up.
That sounds like China.
It's a killer. Nobody wants to do that here. We don't have a walking community here. We need to be able to pull in and see, you know, the parking lot should be in front of the building in the back. If we were in Seattle, where you get a lot of walking traffic, maybe that's a different thing, but it just doesn't work here. And the Piperberry development is a prime example of that. It's just very difficult to make that successful because nobody can see what, you know, you're past it before you know what's there. So.
Thank you. If you want to stick around here at Hood City, you're welcome to.
No, whatever. No more Mountain versus Pierce County. That's the one. You invested at time. Jurisdictions can't just snip some regular from my energy. This can be.
Say goodbye to affordable housing.
Yes.
This is why I do housing.
It's not an issue.
These are decisions of just.
Okay.
They're absolutely consequences.
Yeah.
I will be there.
And if not, have you already done?
Sorry.
No worries. From that, for us to have time for if a referendum was going was that petition was filed to put it on the ballot, we would need to take action by March 28th.
For the November ballot,
to allow sufficient time. So that means I would like Sharon to potentially have our, you know, or Sharon to have our. The framework or our draft code done for our March 21st work study session.
No, my first question as a citizen, as a council member, is what
over the years ran into for our official newspaper. There have been times when the council has wanted the Port Orchard Independent to be our city's official newspaper because it's viewed as our community newspaper. The difference was dollars and pennies. It wasn't in hundreds of dollars in the bid because state law says you have to take the low bid. We at times have had to take, and it's, you know, I've been on the council when we've had that dialogue. State law says we can only take action on certain things at our business meetings, which are the second and fourth. We just painfully, you know, well, I told everybody we can have Christmas week off, and then we had to have a contract.
That was a time management issue.
Yes, it was, but
that wasn't a city council issue.
But you know, we could have dealt with it the week before that. We knew about it the week before, but we couldn't take action on it because this is not a business meeting. I think if we, you know, our code's going to say if we could have noticed, you know, I know transit, we publish at the beginning of the year, here's our meetings for the year, here's the things we're going to take action. I'm not saying, I don't believe that we should have be willy-nilly, you know, doing things differently, but I, you know, if we've got a process to identify when we can take action, then our code, as a code city, we can do things differently as long as we don't violate state law. There's some subtle things I saw in this book when I flipped through it. There's a provision as a code city that you can have a council member pro tem. One of you guys, you know, has medical issue that you're going to recover from, you're going to be off a month or two. There's a provision that we could adopt in a code city that you could appoint a council member pro tem to fill a seat temporarily. Currently, you miss, I think it's 3 meetings, and you lose your council seat.
Three unexcused meetings,
yeah. So there's just subtle differences. I don't think we should put it on the ballot myself, but that's ultimately your guys' decision. We did put money in the budget if we choose to, or if the community says, hey, I don't like this, and I want to put it on. It's primarily going to be support for Sharon. Sharon's not, you know, I know we've got this, but Sharon's not involved in this. It's just, it's attorney resources. And Sharon, I've talked and believe we can get there. I think that we would want to have the framework of it by the 21st. We've got 90 days thereafter to make some tweaks to it, if, you know, as we move forward and implement it 90 days after March 28th, whatever that is.
So let me ask you, the two ways we go about this is an election, or that we as a body, we elect to go forward?
Either it's an election, or you can do it councilmatically if our community says, hey, I don't like this. What, you know, what are you guys doing here? They can circulate a petition and through a referendum can force this to be put on the ballot. And that's where we were 6 or 7 years ago. Petition was circulated and it wasn't thought out from a timing standpoint. We didn't have money in the budget and it would have forced a special election. From a timing standpoint, if we're going to put this on the ballot, we want to put it on a November, you know, when we've got council elections is the most cost-effective way to do that versus us. If we miss that deadline, the next election is in February, and we're paying for a special election, and we don't want that expense.
So if we did this council manually, the community has
90 days
to file a petition.
Well, we need to, what I would propose, if we're going to do this councilmatically, we need to build it at sufficient time. If the community wants it on, says they do want this on the ballot, it allows enough time so that we can get it onto the November.
So when's the deadline to get it onto the November?
March 28th is the last point.
We missed it then.
No. March 28th, we need to take action. So that 90 days from there.
So we still have time to put it on the November ballot.
You only have to let the.
June 30th. Brandy researched that for me. So we worked backwards from the November election to the point to notify the county to the when you guys had to take action, which then I wanted.
My question is, if we were to adopt this council radically by March 29th, that gives a 90 day window.
28th is our council meeting, yeah.
Okay, and that gives them sufficient time that if somebody comes within that 90 days to object, we then could get it onto the November ballot without the process of money.
Without a special election. We would avoid a special election.
What percentage do we have to get on the registry? 1%? The last election versus the last?
What was the question?
What's the percentage? I read this book, not.
Is it 20% of the registered voters, 20% of the population, 20% of those who voted last election?
It wasn't in this book when I read it.
So I remember years ago when this was going through, it seemed like there was more questions than answers, but do you recall the tenor of those that were opposed to going forward with this?
One objection I heard was whether we were going to abolish the Planning Commission. There were so many unanswered questions. Because we had started developing the code, and I think that was a failure of law.
I agree.
And I believe if we're going to do this councilmatically, we owe it to the community to say, this is what our code's going to look like, community, and this is the direction we're going. Versus, we got a good idea here, and trust us, we're going to do the right thing. That isn't going to work. We'll end up having an election.
That works for
Trump. Yeah, it works for Trump, yeah.
And the other thing is initiative of the referendum is not possible.
Yeah, they are. Yes, that's true.
But it
was under Coppola's administration. We ran it the first time as a standalone, okay? And then we started this process councilmatically. The second time it was gone through, it was Mary Whitty, the city manager proposition. Okay. And that one required to go to the ballot. That couldn't be done councilmatically. Okay, so that was a ballot measure. But the first time, we didn't do any of the legwork to develop the code. We said, this is a good idea, we want to do this. We're one of nine cities left. Why are we so far behind the times? Common sense said, we should do that, but we didn't do any of the legwork to develop the code. I think we really, to serve the community properly on this issue, we need to come forward.
So what's involved in developing the code? I mean, we have
there's a lot
of the city now. It's converting it to the code format.
I'm going to defer.
Answering your question. It's the referendum petition has to be signed by qualified electors equal to not less than 10% of votes cast in the last general municipal election.
So registered voters, 10% of the last.
10% of the last municipal election. So it was
municipal or last general?
Municipal. So last city council election. So 10% of that.
So that's a good question about what's it going to take to draft the code. I was looking through it to see if there's a lot more to be done, and I don't have a great idea about that, but I imagine 20 to 40 attorney hours probably for this project, so it's $5,000 to $7,000 based on that, the terms of our resources.
But you said is it differently than just simply taking our current models and putting it into the code format?
It's making sure that we keep the things that don't need to be changed and change the things that do need to be changed.
So going through changing the stuff that we need to change, how do we go through that process?
That's something I'm going to have to look at.
Okay, but it's not like this.
That's just what I was going to say.
If you're going to change it, I want to know about it.
Well, that's what I'm saying. We need to do it before and see what this looks like before we say, we want this. Well, what is this?
Well, you know, that raises an awfully interesting question that I never thought about before. Is that, so we're the last one. What's driving this?
Yeah, see, I do not care if there are, if there's only two cities, and I don't care if they're on the east side or the west side, and I don't care if their population's 50. How does it affect Port Orchard?
Yeah, and why should we?
Why should we? What is it, what benefit do we have? We do not have to have a planning commission. We can make our own rules as long as they're not against state law.
Yeah.
Right now, we can only do rules that are with state law. And if someone wants to annex right now, they have to have 20% of their property owners. And if we're a code city, it's 10%. Those are your major differences. So I haven't been able to find a valid reason as to why we need to do this. Now, you know, Rob has brought up a few minor ones that may be helpful. So, and I don't know what the code's gonna look like. You know, so it's hard for me to make a decision without really seeing the benefits.
The flip side is, what would hurt us?
Yeah, what would hurt us?
If we were to go forward with it, other than spending $5,000-$6,000 to convert our ordinances to code, there are enough advantages. Like, I don't know. I mean, I'm not really interested in the policy or planning commission. That's not a goal for me, at least.
What does the workload look like? Considering I had files between June. What could this possibly add or impact this?
It's a lot less than this.
It's a lot less than this. And yeah, the idea is that I think it wouldn't be changing the substance of most of the code sections, except to update it to make sure that it reflects what code cities can do rather than just what's said. It's really
being a second class city, and that's potentially costly and inefficient.
If there isn't a desire to move this forward,
I guess I'd like to just think about it a little bit longer. I was all for it when I walked in here, but now I'm just like, I'm not quite sure.
What, I think there's a model code out there.
I think there is.
So why don't you share that with me in a PDF and I'll forward that to all of you guys. And maybe we'll bring this back next council meeting as a discussion item. You know, what I don't want to do is I don't want to do this. If we're going to do this, let's do it right.
No, I agree. But let's make sure we want to do it.
Yeah. Exactly. We don't want to put the resources to it if we don't want to do it.
Yeah, if there's some more pros and cons, right? Just like we dealt with that land use, right? There are building issue
recovery aspect of it.
Right, right. So there's other things like that.
We tend to stumble on that as we go to do that.
But the other piece, the time element that I want to bring up is if we have to let the county know by the end of June that we want something, and then looking at backwards, we have to have it by March. Is it critical that we do it this year? Because there will be an election in next year.
We don't pay for it. We're not on that election.
Oh, it has to be. It's every other year, then you have the municipal.
It can be 2 years.
Okay.
Well, I mean, we can contribute to the county's election costs. Yeah. And they would love that, but.
Yeah, okay.
Our least expensive option is this year or 2 years from now.
Okay.
And if it's the desire, we'll put those resources somewhere else, right. And tackle it 2 years from now or never.
Well, we have it until March.
But
Sharon doesn't.
No, I understand that. It's now January 17th, so.
I'd like to give her some direction in another week. I'll get you some more information and what a model code looks like.
It would be incumbent on this group to get that work done before we start this work.
And I think we would. Because the planning commission is right first.
There's not a whole lot of work for us.
Well, except to read the code.
Well, Sharon is going to share what changes occurred.
So it's probably the red line version. Here's what your current code is, and here's what you can do, and so here's our decision points. Do you want this option or not? And so I'll get you a model code, and by the end of the week, because I think AWC's got a model code. And then we'll get it out to the council, and we'll add it to next week's council meeting as a discussion item at the end of the meeting. So, all right, so we're on to the next one. And it's really, we're not done with this yet. Anyway, it is our purchasing policies. And look at this. Procurement policies and procedures. So, Brandy, you want to talk about it?
Yeah, so basically this is just a carry-on from a resolution that was adopted at the December 13th council meeting, basically saying, hey, we need to get some sort of procurement requirements outlined to have in place for staff to follow when we are procuring documents or bids, procedures. So basically, the city needs to update Resolution 009-15 regarding procurement procedures, as it only identifies a portion of the procurement requirements outlined by the state and appears to be stricter than state law. So Resolution 009-15 is the one that typically staff uses to go off of for small works roster processes, the ability to tell the contractor what other requirements such as performance bonds and retainage requirements are. So this resolution is only a portion of what's required by state when going for contract bids or purchasing requirements. So we want to repeal this resolution and bring forth a resolution that adopts a policy which encompasses all purchasing, not just small works projects or really, really small projects under 10,000 or electronic data processing. So this is just a really rough draft that outlines policies set by multiple jurisdictions, and it also models the MRSC's bid policy document. I'm not sure if that's the exact title of it. And if you recall, I believe that Alan brought this forward.
So it's part of the federal processes, and we're going to clean all of this up. It came out of our most recent audit. Matter of fact, the auditor pointed out that your procurement policies are highly restrictive and go well beyond state laws. And matter of fact, right now, if we were following our procurement policies, our public works guys could buy a screwdriver or a hammer with, getting through bids.
So, anything under 70.
Yeah. It's, we when something's broken, if you need a tool or you need a fitting, you need it now and not after you've gone through getting through bids for a $3 hammer. $30.
Or buying paper or binders. Right now, our code states anything under $7,500 we're required three written quotes before proceeding with the purchase. So we're just trying to streamline the processes to be consistent with state law. And the goal is to have you guys review this. Again, this is very rough draft that we still need to vet through the various departments that it affects, as well as legal counsel. And I think the goal is to bring it before council in the next couple meetings.
Well, I don't believe this won't be at next week's meeting, but I would say, safe to say, probably sometime in February. The resolution you passed said we would do it at a minimum of 90 days. I don't think we want to wait to the end of 90 days and ask you to extend it.
And just to confirm, this is going to, so the document that was approved in December of 2016 was for federal projects. We had 90 days to put rules in place that can be either federal or state.
Correct.
And we're intending to all encompassing
both
all of our purchasing policies under one federal state.
And under procurement, we have three main categories of purchasing. There's professional services, and then there's work. So.
And we want to identify all three processes. In a
services,
one final document.
And then services kind of fall in this gray area between columns. So we're working on all that. To make it
very black and white.
So it's likely after staff review, attorney review, this particular policy is going to change.
This is the framework of it. Some of the dollar amounts, and maybe depending on what side of the city you are, state law drives, you know, what those limits are. And we can actually down farther. We're going to bring forward what state law requirements are.
My point is, if we read this now, the changes made, can we get a red line?
Yeah, you'll get a red line, and the changes are going to be pretty minimal. Just dollar amounts, time frames, that type of stuff. Yeah, absolutely.
And then we make wholesale changes.
Right.
No, it's just.
This is darn close.
Just make sure there's no typos, numbers transposed.
Yeah, 95. All right, that's all we have tonight. What I didn't want, the vote thing, Beck and I, and took Beck's criticism, well, we were trying to fix a problem we had, and Mark and I rushed that through without vetting it through a committee or a work study or regular council, and I felt we kind of fumbled through that. So this is an effort to. Here it is, 90 or 95% done. We're trying to vet this because next time you're going to see it's going to be at the dais. And I think when we first blush at it,